Dear members, dear guests, I welcome this possibility to speak to you from Europe. There is no question that we are in the most extraordinary world historical situation, probably in the entire history of mankind. We face an apocalyptic crisis where many crises are coming together. An economic crisis, a starvation crisis, which could lead in its implication concerning both superpowers and the developing countries potentially to global war. We are facing with AIDS for the first time in human history a potentially species-threatening disease. We are facing police dictatorships at many places in the world. We are facing narco-terrorism destroying the lives and minds of many people. There is a spread of Satanism, perversion in pornography of unknown dimensions. But the worst of all of this is that we are faced with a very deep moral crisis. Therefore, it is my deepest conviction that only a worldwide moral renaissance based on the highest conception of man will be the means to get out of this crisis. But let me first discuss some elements of the strategic situation. From my standpoint, the most promising and most hopeful situation are the developments in China right now. When the Chinese students, in a very clever and intelligent way, used the occasion of Gorbachev's visit to take up the fight for freedom, this has changed the world situation. The times of appeasement and detente are over. You all followed the events. For the last days, there were up to 2 million people demonstrating in Peking nearly every day, but not only in Peking, also in Shanghai, in Hong Kong, in many provinces. And the students were joined by workers and representatives of all layers of life. So far, fortunately, the People's Liberation Army has not intervened, showing the inability of the government to crush this. As a matter of fact, very important military men in China have said that the People's Liberation Army cannot be used against the people. Most important in this development is that the students very clearly refer to Sun Yat-sen, who is the father of modern China. That means they are referring to somebody who has modeled his constitution, the constitution he wrote for China, on the Lincoln Gettysburg Address. The famous three principles of Sun Yat-sen, sovereignty, democracy, and economic development for the well-being of the people, are practically a reference to government by the people, through the people, and for the people. And also you have heard that they have put out the slogan, you can't fool all the people all the time. So it is extremely important that what emerges among the fight of the students is the reference to Lincoln and to the concept of a fighting democracy. What that means, I will tell you a little bit later on when I discuss the book by General Tang, Turning Defeat into Victory. Also, the students have brought forward in Shanghai the Statue of Liberty. Furthermore, in Peking, they have been playing Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, the Ode to Joy, which in my view is one of the most beautiful celebrations of the idea of freedom of man. And, very important, they call themselves a moral renaissance movement. Therefore, I think that this emergence for the fight of freedom in the largest country in the world, after all, the mainland Chinese people probably are 1.2 billion people, in all likelihood is the true turning point in history of building the resistance movement against communist and fascist dictatorships. Well, also, it has big strategic relevance because it is the first time that Gorbachev has been facing a policy defeat. It's the first time that one of his diplomatic activities was a complete failure. Up to that point, Gorbachev went from one place to the next and he you know, just had one success after the other. But this was a complete debacle for him. And the significance of this is that this means that the multipolar world, Carter, Brzezinski, Kissinger, and Bush have been talking about in the recent period, is blowing apart very quickly. Gorbachev lost China as part of the world condominium and the world government he was trying to construct. And with China, he also lost Asia, i.e. that means 40% of the idea of running a global crisis management through a condominium are gone. Well, I must say, last year in August, when Lynn and I were in Taiwan, and we met the old KMT Kuomintang leadership, we had many days discussions, and General Tang and others told us that their aim was to reconquer the mainland. And I must say, even so I was listening with interest and hope that this may be true, I must say now only, you know, a couple of months later, we are in May 89, I must say I'm really positively surprised about these developments. General Tang, I think, is a very influential person in what is happening in China right now. He is one of the great five old men of modern China. He designed the plan to defeat the Japanese, and he wrote this beautiful booklet, Turning Defeat into Victory, a total war strategy against Peking. The basic thesis of this book is that he thinks that the countdown, which side, which China, Taiwan, or the communist China would win, this countdown is on. The timetable has been defined by the enemy, and he refers to a statement which Deng Xiaoping made in 1980, where he announced that by 1990, the takeover of Taiwan and the unification of China under communist rule should be completed. As General Tang and the other people we spoke to told us at the time, this would be a total war where either one side would win for sure. Therefore, he developed the concept of the people's war, i.e. that the war has to take place on all fronts of life. And he correctly said only 10% of this war are military and 90% are cultural. Well, I think it is very important to look closely what is the difference between the two systems. Taiwan clearly is in the tradition of Sun Yat-sen, the father of modern China. He was the one who overthrew the last dynasty, and one can say he did a tremendous job by traveling 6 times around the world. He was an excellent political organizer and an even better political fundraiser, because he organized many millions to finance the revolution. Very important is that he was a Christian, which especially in Asia is very important for the image of man, because the Christian idea of man simply gives people a higher sense of the sacredness of human life. Chiang Kai-shek was his closest collaborator, and it was he and the presidency of Chiang Kai-shek's son which turned Taiwan from a very poor island into one of the most modern industrial countries outside of the industrialized sector. Why did they do this? Well, they understood that the development of infrastructure, industry, and agriculture was absolutely essential if a better life for all citizens in Taiwan had to be accomplished. So 40 years ago, basically when the Kuomintang had to flee from the mainland, the economic basis of both the mainland and the island were exactly the same. But now the difference is tremendous. It is absolutely huge, because in mainland China today, 100 million people are threatened with starvation. And the general inflation has taken away the living standard of the already very poor population. So it is interesting to look at, you know, how the Chinese are looking at that. Well, what is little known is that after the Yalta treason of Tehran, Yalta, and Potsdam, where the sellout of Eastern Europe occurred, totally unnecessarily, through Stalin, Roosevelt and Churchill. And if you look at, if you imagine a world map and then think how the communist countries have increased on this world map through the Yalta sellout, well, then one can say that this very same treason continued in 49 when it was the combination of Moscow and Washington working together to give weapons to Mao Zedong and that way changing the balance to the disadvantage of Chiang Kai-shek, who had to go to Taiwan. So the world map, if you imagine it, the communist camp got even bigger. But this treason continued because during the Korean War, Chiang Kai-shek offered hundreds of thousands of troops from Taiwan to go to the mainland to open up a second front to help MacArthur. But what did the United States government do? Rather than taking this, which would have changed the Korean War outcome quite significantly, the 7th Fleet was deployed in the Strait of China to create a cordon sanitaire around Taiwan. And this was simply treason. As a matter of fact, MacArthur was so embarrassed and ashamed that he flew to Taipei to apologize to Chiang Kai-shek, and as you know, shortly after he had to resign. But this treason was continued when in 71, Kissinger and Nixon, but especially Kissinger, started the China card policy, and then subsequently forced all the countries of the world to cut diplomatic relations with the non-communist Taiwan and to open diplomatic relation with communist China instead. And, you know, Maoism was really a rather ugly thing, not only that it caused one of the most horrible continuous genocides inside China, but also Mao consciously modeled himself on the first Chinese emperor who did the first book burning and is the symbol for destruction of intellectual development and so forth. So it is against this relict of Maoism and the horrors of the Cultural Revolution that the students' demonstrations are occurring today. It is also modeled on the revolution of 1919, which was at that time occurring against the treason of the Versailles Treaty, where the participating powers basically decided to give all the things which previously belonged to Germany, i.e. the rights and territories, to Japan. And there was an uproar, a nationalist patriotic uproar against this occurrence. And today, quite similar, what is behind the Chinese revolt of the students is a protest against the global crisis management Anglo-American Soviet condominium, which basically would violate national sovereignty of China in a true sense. So therefore, basically, this, I think, is changing the world. And according to our best information at this point, this development is irreversible. And that means, as even the Japanese have recognized, that détente is over and this horrible sellout appeasement of Neville Chamberlain, of the Neville Chamberlain tradition is coming to an end. Because what was the strategic situation before this recent Chinese development occurred? The decoupling of Western Europe was fully underway, and in a certain way it still is. Because what the superpowers were acting on was the new Yalta division of the world, according to the plan which Andropov announced in 1983, according to which Western Europe would fall under the hegemony of Moscow, the United States would be limited to the Western Hemisphere, and the rest of the world would be pretty much shared by both superpowers in a crisis management, regional crisis management. Many of you don't know the history of the Schiller Institute, so therefore let me quickly refer to it. I personally recognized in the years 82, beginning 83, that there was a danger of decoupling of the Western alliance. Because in Europe, among conservative people, I all of a sudden noticed that people were talking about Brezhnev as the peace-loving person and Reagan as the warmongerer. And I had the distinct feeling that if this development would continue, at a certain point, it would be a threat to the Western alliance, simply because Moscow has never given up their idea that once they have Germany, this will be the stepping stone to conquer all of Western Europe, and that will be then the way to world hegemony. So I wrote a memorandum first to the Reagan administration, suggesting that they should found or organize a European-American Friendship Institute, in which basically both countries would refer to each other based on the best tradition, i.e. the American Revolution and the European Renaissance and classical periods, and not get involved in stupid trade wars and other quarrelings. So basically, this could have worked, I'm quite sure. The only problem, as I subsequently found out, is all the people I spoke and Lynn spoke with in the National Security Council and in the Pentagon, most people, or nearly all people I spoke with, turned out to be later Project Democracy and part of the parallel government apparatus. The secret government. So, you know, here I try to present a concept to people who believe that foreign policy is simply covert operations, running coups, subverting, and simply trying to get not caught as the only moral. While the principles of the Schiller Institute from the beginning were the question of national sovereignty, a republican foreign policy, and to establish a world order of a community of principle, in the same way like the founding fathers were thinking about the relations to other countries. The Schiller Institute was supposed to be the instrument to make possible the realization of a new just world economic order based on the principles of Populorum Progressio, the encyclical which discusses the idea of the development of all people. But obviously, this was not the kind of thinking which the parallel government people I was speaking with had. And the problem is that now the parallel government is the government in the United States. And we have this, for Europeans, really horrible combination of Bush, Kissinger, and Carter, a combination which is really very, very awful. And there is no question that they right now want to sell out Western Europe to the Soviet Union. As a matter of fact, the so-called Kissinger Plan, which was endorsed by Baker, proposes to have a neutralized Middle Europe, which obviously, given the geographical and historical situation, would never be neutral, but would come under Soviet hegemony like the rest of the East Bloc. So this treason, you know, started already during the Reagan administration with the signing of the INF Treaty. This is all the more stupid and all the more outrageous because the Soviet Empire is collapsing. So with whom are they making this deal? The Soviet Empire right now is undergoing an economic crisis, a food shortage, and an uprising of the nationalities, which will mean the irreversible collapse and end of Soviet imperialism. Gorbachev has, with the recent moves, managed to increase his control over the nomenklatura, but that has not helped him to get more control over the empire, because these problems I just named are just too real. Right now, there is a big leadership fight in Moscow after the China trip. But what a stupidity to sell out Western Europe and many parts of the rest of the world at a point when the Soviet Empire is collapsing, and one should rather think how to free the suppressed countries of the East. While all of this has very much to do with the betrayal of the United States government against Lynn, because he, as an American patriot, has written all the concepts needed to remedy the US strategic problems. He is generally respected in Europe as the author of the SDI, because we presented this concept 1 year before Reagan announced it in March 83. Well, but he has also, he has become a symbol for the Western alliance based on moral and economic strength. And to negotiate with the Soviet Union, not from the standpoint of unilateral disarmament, but from a position of strength. Lynn is the symbol in the world of third world development, and how easy it would be to win the friendship of all these countries if you just would let them develop the way they want. Lynn is the author of the War on Drugs. Lynn was practically the first politician to recognize the potential catastrophic effects of AIDS, and he proposed a crash program to overcome it. And everybody in the whole world knows he stands for the America of the American Revolution, of Lincoln, of Martin Luther King, i.e. in America, every foreigner can relate to very, very easily and even love it. So when they put Lynn in jail, the US government and the US establishment decided not only against Lynn, but against his policies, the policies everybody knows he's standing for. And I can only assure you that the reactions worldwide among Lynn's friends was one of total shock. What does that mean about the United States if they treat one of their greatest sons in this way? Well, it is unfortunately the common understanding of many people who independently came to this judgment that if they put a man in jail with so many laws broken as it occurred in this case, this means the United States is on the way to become a fascist dictatorship. Not Mussolini style, not Hitler style, but an American version of a dictatorship, fascist dictatorship. Well, look, I mean, if you look what is the United States, Bush and so forth is now doing, threatening against Panama, and what is their relation to communist China? What a farce is it? They always claimed that they have to do the Contra policy because it's a fight against communism, which Lynn always opposed because he correctly said that the Contras were nothing but drug pushers. What about the US fight against communism in China? Baker said that the Chinese regime in Peking is a friendly government and therefore no destabilization should occur. So he is for the Chinese communist leadership turning against the students which are hailing the ideals of the American Revolution. What a farce. So I think, unfortunately, I have to fully agree with the government communique the government of Panama has put out, saying that the United States are committing crimes against humanity, quite in the same way as it was defined in the Nuremberg trial, and that they are committing state terrorism. And, you know, state terrorism normally is conducted by governments like Libya, Syria, or Iran. So it is a fact one has to really start to think about and what it means in terms of the implication that the United States is going fascist. If the United States were to intervene militarily in the next period in Panama, I already said that this would be Bush's Sudeten crisis, i.e. what Hitler did when World War II started. The American version of fascism is not, as I said, the previous historical models, but it is the same kind of suppression inside and outside which Martin Luther King fought against when the FBI was harassing the black people with incredible means. It's the arrogance of the little sheriffs breaking the law because they know that the establishment above is backing their illegal actions. And it's the kind of KKK racism which leads to lynch mobs, and as we have seen it in the state of Virginia against Lynn and our other people. What does it do to the minds of people if there is no more sense of right and wrong, but you have a juridical dictatorship where, because you cannot afford the lawyers, you have to plea bargain if you are guilty or not? And unfortunately, it looks like Bush is adopting Teddy Roosevelt as his ideal by imitating his gunboat diplomacy and covert operations. The philosophy behind this is what Nietzsche, one of the authors of fascism, said, namely that the will for power is the highest value. These people behave like the gods of Olympus, who do not recognize a higher authority than themselves. They follow the philosophy that everything is allowed as long as you're not being caught. And, well, this is unfortunately Bush, the president of that establishment which thinks like that. And I can tell you, when an elite, a so-called elite, is no longer accepting a higher authority, this is what Nicolaus of Cus would call satanic arrogance. But the United States policy is already right now against the Third World, backing the US banks and the IMF in terms of incredible usury. Well, Mubarak, the president of Egypt, just gave a speech to the World Food Council where he said that conservatively estimated, since the beginning of the decade, because of the financial policies, 512 million people died. 512 since the beginning of the 80s. Well, we have said in the past that the IMF is pushing policies 100 times worse than Adolf Hitler, and if 500 million people die, just, you know, I mean, I think that speaks a language for itself. But also, if you look at the policy of the United States against the elderly, this is euthanasia, nothing else. So the last 12 years of US policy from Carter, Kissinger and Bush, well, they are going in this direction. And one also should know that the Pentagon knows what's going on in Africa, but they have written it off. It should be depopulated of black people. That is their design. The world today is threatened with New Age, a horrible new form of fascist esoteric thinking, the spread of Satanism in a very aggressive form, pornography of ugliness, which is simply poisoning the mind of people. And as I said, we are in a very, very deep moral crisis. The key problem is the absence of God in the minds of people. What Cusa calls the satanic arrogance, that is the source of all evil. And this is the reason why now in the year of the 505th anniversary of the Council of Florence, we just had a beautiful conference in Rome where we celebrated these ideas also to find answers for our problems today. Because the Council of Florence, which brought together all the churches and all the artists and all the great thinkers of that time, was the high point of the Italian Renaissance. And as you know, what was before was the 14th century, which was a horrible dark age in which you had, the Black Death killing more than one third of all the people from India to Iceland. You had superstition, witchcraft, economic collapse. And we wanted to study how did people proceed to come out of this dark age and reach this beautiful golden age of the Italian Renaissance. Well, the situation of the church was also very complicated because at the Council of Basel, you had schisms and you had the conciliar movement, which was as confused and wrong as many of the nationalist churches and theologians today. The greatest mind of this period was Nicolaus of Cusa, who already at the Council of Basel wrote the beautiful work Concordantia Catholica, which was an idea how to find unity among the different parts of the church and among the nations by simply making possible the development of all based on natural law. He came to the conclusion that unity can never occur on some secondary order, and therefore he was one of the persons who were most instrumental to bring the Greek Orthodox Church together with the Rome Church. But he also knew that the main question was the question of the filioque. This question is the most important, in my view, of all mankind. The filioque question is the question, does the Holy Spirit emanate only from the father or also in the same full way from the son. The Greek Orthodox Church at that time did not assume that. The Romans did. And obviously the difference is tremendous because, well, if you have a consubstantiality of God and man united in Christ, so that Christ is totally God, fully God, but also fully man, well, that means that Christianity all of a sudden is the only religion in which man can participate directly in God. And this is very important, because if the Holy Ghost only emanates from the Father, then, you know, people have to look up to God and he's like a distant authority. While if it's mediated through Christ, their ability to participate in God is much more direct. This also has tremendous relevance for the creative identity of people, because Nikolaus von Kues understood each human being to be the microcosm of the macrocosm, i.e. to be the microcosm, microcosm of the universe in totality, and therefore reflecting in his mind, while, you know, he is engaged in creative activity, the laws of creation. So man, therefore, has the duty to contribute to the process of creation as imago viva Dei, as the living image of God. Therefore, it is our duty to imitate Christ, because we have to develop all potential capabilities for the well-being of mankind, and so contribute to the necanthropic development of the universe. This is the source of our self-conception and the identity, i.e. that we are in the image of God. Well, this is directly and unmediated through our creative activity. This gives us inner authority. This is the source of the dignity of man. This is the source to be, that we are in the image of God. This is the source of the inalienable rights of all people. To be a Christian in this sense means that you have to work on your self-perfection, to become more and more like God, obviously without ever reaching God, but to come closer and closer and closer. And it is against this beautiful image of man against which Satanism is directed. Because this idea of man being capax Dei, participating in God, is the basis of our individual freedom. And it's quite obvious that dictatorships, they don't like free individuals, and therefore there is no question that dictatorships are promoting Satanism, because it takes exactly this basis away. But this conception touches upon the very question of the meaning of life itself. And this is a very personal question one has to ask oneself, especially when we are faced with such a deep apocalyptic crisis. It's a personal moral question for all of you and all of us. The question is, do you love God? You must find your personal relationship to God. And therefore, I want to read you the 13th Corinthian letter. If I spoke with human tongue and with the tongue of an angel and had not love, I would be resounding metal or ringing shell. And could I speak as a prophet and knew all secrets and all knowledge and had all faith, so that I could move mountains and had love not, so I were nothing. And if I gave all my possessions to the poor and let my body be burned and had love not, so were I no use to me. Love is patient and friendly. Love does not enter contests. Love leadeth not wantonness. Love does not boast. Love does not behave unseemly. Love does not covet, nor does love itself to be allow itself to be embittered. Love does not account with evil. Love takes no joy in injustice, but delights in the truth. Love endures all, believes all, hopes all, suffers all. Love does never cease, where yet prophetic speech will cease, and speaking in tongues will cease, and knowledge will cease. For our knowledge is but patchwork, and our prophetic speaking is patchwork. But upon the arrival of the perfect one, the patchwork will cease. When I was a child, I spoke as a child, and thought as a child, and was wise as a child. But when I became a man, I put aside what was childish. We see now as in a mirror darkly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know partially, but then I shall know how I am known. But now there remain faith, hope, love, these three. But love is the greatest among them. This also is the essence of Lynn's method and the method of the organization. Lynn has spoken many times about agape. This is the reason why Lynn decided to take the cup of Gethsemane and face a process which had nothing to do with law, but which was a political witch hunt and prosecution. Because he said that in a situation where there are no more principles visible for people, because lawlessness has broken out, there has to be somebody standing up for these principles. Lynn is a very, you know, philosophical mind in the sense, you know, Schiller is using this term, i.e. that a philosophical mind loves the truth more than any system. And he takes the system apart first to build it more perfectly afterwards together. Lynn is doing all these creative things he has been doing out of a sense of love to mankind. That is the basis of his truth seeking. And love to mankind is only possible out of love to God. This is very important because you have to take the misery of all human beings into your heart, knowing that each life is sacred. As the American Constitution says, all men are created equal. And for you, the babies in Africa who are dying and have no hope without us must be as important to you like your own children. Right now, we have reached a crossroad in human history. There are two ways mankind can go. Either we will face a world of horrible dictatorships, new age fascism, zombies, youths which are running around with Walkman in the ear, and you can be sure that nothing happens in their mind. The United States joining the empire of evil, of which Reagan correctly spoke, and becoming one itself. Run and controlled by a small degenerate elite, by an increase in the drug counterculture, by the uncontrolled spread of AIDS, and by a fascist dictatorship worked through things like the Federal Emergency Management Agency. Well, this world would be dominated by the philosophy of Nietzsche, to seek power for power's sake, and this world would end in chaos and be total hell. Or we work to achieve a moral renaissance and to accomplish very, very soon a just new world economic order based on the image of man in the image of God. That we would fight that each human being is becoming a beautiful soul, that each child on this planet has the chance to develop everything he or she is capable of. Well, I want to tell you, this is the philosophical commitment of our organization, to bring forward the divine potential in each human being. And I tell you, our time has come. I want to congratulate the fighting spirit of the US organization, who has not collapsed in front of tyranny. And I now say that the same fighting spirit with the determination to win shows up in China. This is the beginning of a process in which dictatorships will be overcome and a world order will be established which is more worthy of the dignity of man. Therefore, no matter how difficult the situation in the United States looks right now, we will turn defeat into victory. because I believe that that is the will of Providence and our time has come.
As most of you know, I'm the first of the Virginia defendants to have been tried. And as most of you know, on April 5th of this year, I was convicted of so-called securities fraud and sentenced to serve 86 years in the Virginia State Penitentiary for Women. Unlike Mr. LaRouche and his six co-defendants who've been in the Alexandria Detention Center for 122 days now, I'm able to speak here today only because I'm out of jail for 60 days on a $50,000 surety bond. I have 8 days left. On June 5th, I go before Judge Carlton Penn for final sentencing. Judge Penn has already denied me bail pending appeal. This 86-year sentence is the most severe sentence ever handed down to a so-called first offender in the history of the Commonwealth of Virginia. Now, Lynn has recently stated that the state of Virginia has crossed the line to becoming an overtly fascist state. And I want to make clear to people today exactly what he means by this. Imagine a place in which grand juries meet in secret. There are no transcripts or written records of any kind. This is the state of Virginia. Now, in comparison, in the New York case, after the judge reviewed transcripts of the grand jury proceedings, he dismissed something like 70 of the 89 counts of the indictment. In Virginia, there's no transcripts to review. In Virginia, juries, not judges, do sentencing. And juries are not allowed to run sentences concurrently. Virginia's one of only six states in the United States where this goes on, despite numerous charges that it's unconstitutional. Now, imagine a state in the United States of America in which until 18 months ago there were no courts of appeal. If you were found guilty, your only remedy was to appeal to the state Supreme Court, which does not have to hear your appeal. In the last 18 months since they did establish courts of appeal, the judge who will sentence me on June 5th has been reversed 13 times. Imagine a state in which the law says you do not have the right to be told in advance who the witnesses are against you, what evidence will be brought against you, who are your so-called co-conspirators. Unindicted co-conspirators can be added at will, whether or not you've even been charged with conspiracy. This is the state of Virginia, or what they call it the Commonwealth of Virginia. And one more thing, unlike in any other state, to my knowledge, in the United States of America, where judges are either elected or they're appointed by a merit board, in Virginia, judges are selected by the same blue blood Confederate families that run the General Assembly. Now, a few of the specifics of this case. Some people may know this, but I want people to know firsthand what was done to understand how far this fascist process has gone in the United States of America. Also because it's the exact same ID format case brought by the same Gett LaRouche task force who ran the Boston and the Alexandria prosecution. I was arrested on the night of February 17th of 1987, along with 14 other people who are sitting in this room today, and Mike Billington, who is with Lynn in Alexandria. Maryland and Virginia State Police knocked on our office door. We were handcuffed. We were taken to jail. The charge was securities fraud. We were later told the nature of our crime. We should have registered as stockbrokers when taking loans for political campaigns. We should have registered these loans with the State Corporation Commission as securities, i.e. as stocks and bonds. Well, that's fine, except that the statute in question, which is the Virginia Securities Act, has never, ever been used in the state of Virginia against any politician or any political organization. If it had, Governor Belisle, who is the current governor and took 70% of his campaign money in loans, Senator Warner, Senator Robb, the state legislators, they'd also be in jail. Now, even more incredible, at the time of our arrest, there was no such crime. This is the way that law works in the Soviet Union. First you're arrested, and then they create a crime. But they're more honest about it in the Soviet Union. In the Soviet Union, they call you an enemy of the state. In our case, the so-called crime was manufactured 3 months after we were arrested. The State Corporation Commission met 3 months after we were thrown in jail to debate whether or not the promissory notes in question were or were not securities under their law. This fact we brought before Judge Penn in pretrial motions, since it's illegal and then it's illegal to indict and then ex post facto create a crime to fit the indictment. And the ex post facto motion was dismissed out of hand. Now, I was also charged with a thought crime, intent to defraud, which increases the charges to felonies, each count carrying a maximum sentence of 10 years. The argument of the Commonwealth of Virginia is that at the time these loans were taken, we never intended to repay them. What the court refused to hear, I mean, in Lynn's case, they actually passed an in limine motion of this effect, was a very simple fact. The same government prosecuting us for not intending to repay is the government that ran financial warfare against this organization since its inception, and then placed the not-for-profit corporations and tax-exempt foundations affiliated with Mr. LaRouche in Chapter 7 involuntary bankruptcy in April of 1987, making it both impossible and illegal to repay one penny. In a police state action unprecedented in American history, these companies were placed under U.S. government trustee. All bank accounts and assets were seized, all offices closed. This means it was legally impossible to repay. All the loans named in the substantive counts of my indictment were due after the government forced bankruptcy. Then the fact of the so-called non-payment was made an element of my crime, proving my, quote, intent to defraud. 18 months after I was indicted for securities fraud, an additional indictment was handed down against me and several of my co-defendants. Without revisiting a grand jury, the government charged me with conspiracy. Now, this is the mark of an overtly fascist state. Under the Nazi legal code, the Nazis called this guilt by analogy, guilt by association, thought crime. Under conspiracy law in the state of Virginia, anything goes. The government can name anyone as an unindicted co-conspirator right in the middle of the trial. They can just add names at will. You're not given these names before trial. And you have to defend yourself against these people on the grounds that you are, as their co-conspirator, responsible for their thoughts and their actions. This included testimony from literal Judases who lied, who were granted immunity from prosecution for their testimony, and then named my co-conspirators. My case was tried in Leesburg, Virginia, which is the international headquarters of the LaRouche movement. This town has been the center of the most vicious press lies, attacks, and publicity against Lynn, culminating in a pre-dawn raid against our headquarters involving 400 members of the FBI, the ATF, the IRS, the state police, the Secret Service, armed with Uzis, helicopters, armored personnel carriers. We filed approximately 24 motions pre-trial to move the case out of Leesburg. The judge ruled that people don't read newspapers. So we began jury selection in the middle of this lynch mob atmosphere the same week that Lynn and his six co-defendants were sentenced to 15 years in prison for the same so-called crime. The judge, of course, forgot to tell anybody not to read the newspapers. This was the longest jury selection in the history of the county and possibly in the history of the state. The judge, to seat a jury, finally resorted to the following formulation. He would say to each prospective juror, "This case involves the fundraising practices of individuals and organizations associated with Lyndon LaRouche. I am sure that you've read something about this in the newspapers or heard something of this in the media. Can you put aside everything that you have heard and judge this case solely on the basis of its merit?" On this basis, jurors who expressed the most vile bias were seated if they could assure the judge that they could put this out of their mind for the purpose of the trial. The only difference between this and the LaRouche case in Alexandria, where the jury selection took 1 hour and 45 minutes, is that we got to hear the filth pour out of people's mouths for 2 weeks before they were seated on the jury. People who said LaRouche is an extremist, a neo-Nazi, a racist, an anti-Semite, a threat to the country, got what he deserves. But yes, sure, Your Honor, I can put aside my personal opinions about the man and his organization to sit on this jury. Just by the way, 5 days into the trial, it was too much even for this judge. He invited a change of venue, which means all the 15 other trials have been moved out of Leesburg. They've been moved to Roanoke. The judge's argument is that I got the last 12 honest jurors in Loudoun County. So I will not force people to listen to what went on for 13 weeks of this trial. But the final straw, which you should know, was the judge's charge to the jury. Because as bad as the jury was, this proves the ultimate nature of a police state. There was nothing really for the jury to decide. First, the judge ruled that any piece of paper, an IOU on the back of a piece of toilet paper, indicating indebtedness, was a security. He eliminated even the language in the statute which states, unless the context otherwise specifies, which clearly exempts political fundraising and political organizing guaranteed under the First Amendment. So this was a directed verdict on the misdemeanor, leaving only the question of my intent for the felony count. But this is even more incredible. Instruction number 35 from the judge stated all that the jury had to find, and this is a direct quote, was that I had, quote, participated in any way to bring about this crime, whether such crime was originally contemplated or not. So innocence is no defense in the state of Virginia. To be found guilty of a felony, to be found guilty of intent, which is a felony, under the U.S. Constitution, you have to knowingly and willingly commit a crime. The chart says participated in any way to bring about this crime, whether such crime was originally contemplated or not. Now, the state of Virginia has gone over the edge to full-fledged fascism, but this is not an aberration. As I said, the Virginia case is being run by the same Get LaRouche task force that ran the Boston and the Alexandria prosecutions. The chief prosecutor in both those cases, who came to Leesburg to sit in on and run my case, is the same John Markham, who we've just identified as an avowed practicing Satanist from the Process Church. This is the church responsible for virtually every mass murder in this country during the 1960s and the 1970s. He was chosen by the DOJ precisely because he's a practicing Satanist. So, what are the real crimes of myself and Mr. LaRouche? Our real crime, as far as the enemy is concerned, is embodied in Mr. LaRouche's call for the formation of an anti-Bolshevik resistance. Our crime is not simply that we represent the only independent political movement in the United States with the courage to stand up to defeat Satanism and drugs, the death and destruction brought by the IMF, and the surrender of 300 million Europeans to the Soviet Empire. The Soviets and their Satanist allies hate this man LaRouche and hate this movement more than anything that they have hated since the birth of Christ. They hate us because we're the direct heirs to the Council of Florence, which Helga discussed. The issue is the conception of man embodied in the filioque. The issue is the issue debated at that conference, the conception of man based on man's continual process of perfection in the image of the living God. We in this room are the heirs to this legacy. It's this that the enemies of mankind cannot stand and this that they cannot defeat. These bastards thought they could break us. They offered Lynn deal after deal. They offered me plea bargains, a cap on my sentence if I would just plead guilty. When I refused, they made the same offer to my 15 co-defendants, offering them caps on their sentences and on my sentence if just one of them would break and plead guilty. We all refused. They got my family to call and suggest that I plead guilty. Like typical Americans, they said, nothing is so important that it's worth going to jail over. Now, this is where the enemy is wrong. I plan to do everything in my power to beat this and to guarantee that Lynn and his co-defendants in Alexandria are free. It's the greatest travesty of history that Lynn's in jail at this moment of history, you know, especially with millions of Chinese students saying, give me liberty or give me death. But this is the issue which every person here has to answer. Do you have principles so precious that you would gladly die for those principles? Lynn has taken the point on this for all of mankind. Lynn described this kind of courage in one of his last public speeches. This was the speech that he gave while he was on trial at the Food for Peace conference. And he said, and I quote, he said, you have to look to something deeper in yourself. You have to look to the kind of courage which defines martyrs, which is not some grand and exceptional thing. It's a very important thing, but it's not a grand exceptional thing which happens only to a few. There are many martyrs in history above and beyond those who are celebrated ones in name. When you're faced with that kind of situation, of dying perhaps an anonymous death in a remote village with no one to put a marker on your grave, no uniform in which to be buried, and you look within yourself and you say, do you have the courage to do that? Most Americans would say when looking at themselves, they'd say, no, I wish to survive. I will compromise with anything for survival. Some would have to say they'd compromise for the purpose of enjoying an extra moment's additional pleasure, whatever they imagine that pleasure to be. In order to deal with the kind of crisis that confronts us, we must look within ourselves and find a value within us so precious that if we spent our life to defend that value, we would have thereby gained our lives, because we have gained the purpose of our mortal existence. Lynn said, to know what Benjamin Franklin and the others represented, a system of representative self-government under natural law and under law governed by natural law. Imagine the horror of having known such a form of self-government and then to live under slavery, which is not only a material oppression, but a destruction of the very soul of one's children, as we are slaves today in the United States. This quality of man is what we in this room represent. This is why the enemy shudders in horror and fear. This is why we're the direct descendants charged with carrying on the work of the Council of Florence to once again pull the world out of a new dark age. Now, as Lynn said, it is not exceptional. Every person in this room can make this decision. I will end here by quoting from Lynn one more time. This was Lynn's response to the Pope in the papal encyclical on Solicitudo Rei Socialis. Lynn said, all leaders for a time of crisis partake of the circumstances of Francis Joan of Arc, as I have read a kindred experience respecting his call to duty in the eyes of John Paul II. Up to a critical point in our lives, we plot our craft and pursue our moral commitments honestly to the limit of our knowledge and strength of will to do so. In that respect, we are all ordinary. Then one day, to some among us ordinary folk, there comes an experience which we must fairly liken to the New Testament's account of Christ in Gethsemane. It is not enough to propose, to foster, to support those causes we know to be good. A silent voice speaks to us. If there is no one else to lead, you must do so. We protest. Who am I? And what are my poor means to undertake such a mission? Can there not be leaders which I can support and so fulfill the responsibility in a manner consistent with my pitiable means? Then in a moment, permeated with a special quality of terror, we know we must drink from that cup. What do most ordinary folk of the sort we were a moment earlier know of such terror? To know such terror, one must first love mankind and love truth. One must see mankind as doomed to some horrible consequence unless a great change is made. The terror is the perception that this necessary change will not occur unless one oneself acts appropriately to bring it about against all odds. As one drinks from that cup, there's a transformation in the nature of one's will and a congruent transformation in one's state of knowledge. Now, I have 8 days 8 days is certainly enough time to destroy John Markham. So Lynn says we need 5 million leaflets to do it. We may not be able to beat these bastards in the courts of Virginia, but we can certainly do it in the streets. So Lynn ended his response to the Pope by saying, "I have drunk from that cup." And I say we all pledge ourselves today to join Lynn and the others in Alexandria so that we too drink from that cup. Thank you.